Hello students, welcome to EPG Patshala. I am Dr. N. Shivasenani from University of Hyderabad. Under the topic Vedic, Epic and Puranic Culture, today we study the module Polity in Ramayana. Our learning objectives are understand the system of government, especially the interplay amongst king, sabha and dharma. We also seek to understand the organization of society, both politically and administratively. We'll also look at interstate relations in military affairs, and then wrap up with a consideration of the continuity of polity of India before Ramayana and post-Ramayana as well. The way a society organizes itself is a very important aspect when we try to understand the culture during any period. In Ramayana, much information is available about the polity, as many of the key incidents in Ramayana, such as the impending coronation of Rama as Yuvaraja and his subsequent banishment, are firmly within the political domain. We consider some of these aspects, and at the end we also look at continuity of polity both from pre-Ramayana times and post-Ramayana times. As explained earlier in other modules, dharma is both what is upheld and the upholder. It is that which, when followed, leads to the maximum good of the people. Economists call it the Pareto maximum. It is both constitution and also the code of morals, ethics and values. In the Ramayana state, upholding dharma was the duty of the king. Thus, the king upheld dharma, and dharma is what protected the king. If the king were good, there would be no famine, no untimely deaths, etc. in a kingdom. Generally, the people were all happy, and such a king enjoyed popular support. To decide on questions of dharma, the sabha was consulted. This was the primary relationship amongst these three. Questions of dharma are not straightforward. Let us just look at an example. We know the incident when Dasharatha's boons, so-called boons, were communicated to Rama. So now that he's been asked to go to the forest, what could he do? There were three suggestions given to him. First one, given by Lakshmana, was, brother, why don't you kill father and then ascend the throne? The second suggestion was given by Dasharatha himself. He pleads Rama, imprison me and then ascend the throne. If Dasharatha is imprisoned, then he is no longer capable of sanctioning his boons. Therefore, it is still dharma. And then Vasishtha says, there is no need to do any of this. Rama, you go out and start another kingdom. The people will follow you. We'll see that in the times of Ramayana, new kingdoms are started all the time. Now, Rama's reaction to all these three is very interesting. He doesn't say any of these three is adharma. He accepts them as kshatra dharma, the warrior code, but says that he wants to follow the sadharana dharma because he also wants his father to be known as a man who kept his word. So we see that in a given situation, there are four different possible actions, all seemingly within the realm of dharma. So it will be appreciated that questions of dharma are complicated. Since the king was supposed to follow and uphold dharma, Rama is celebrated as the personification of dharma. We have this shloka from Ramayana. Ramo vigrahavan dharmaha, sadhu satya parakramaha, raja sarvasya lokasya devanamiva vasavaha. The very famous line, Ramo vigrahavan dharmaha. Rama is dharma personified, the ideal king. This was the relation between dharma and the king. Sovereignty lies with the king. There are some historians who tried to say that sovereignty lies with the sabha. But anybody who considers the literature, ancient literature as a whole, has to conclude that sovereignty firmly lies with the king. In fact, it is repeated in many places. It's worth repetition here. It is due to the king that there is order in the society and law is followed. In other words, the king alone upholds dharma. Arajakatva, anarchy or kinglessness, is much dreaded. In Ayodhya Kanda 2.67, immediately after the death of Dasharatha, the evils of Arajakatva are bemoaned before the council of Amatyas and Mantris requests Vasishtha to invite a prince to be the king. There was a vacuum in Ayodhya when Rama left for the forest and Dasharatha died. That's when this happened. All aspects related to the king, his training, his daily schedule, his advisors, formal assemblies such as Sabha, etc., are all designed to ensure that the king follows Dharma. We can briefly look at the education duties of king. The education of a prince, the syllabus included Vedas, Vedangas, sciences, arts and literature, and then extensive military training, especially in Dhanurveda, riding and breaking of horses and elephants, military tactics, strategies, etc. You will find that this list starts with Vedas. Dharma is at the top of the list. If we minutely look at the trainings and duties that the king received, self-control is emphasized above all. King should take a decision only after consulting with his ministers. Then decision once taken should be implemented without delay. A king's decision should not be known to anybody. It should be known only after the results are known. It should be known from results. Kings should personally attend to royal duties. In case the king is leaving the capital, adequate arrangements must be made for administration. King should respect public opinion. If you look at all these various aspects, it comes out that king training was designed to ensure that Dharma is upheld. Now, what is the relation between Sabha and Dharma? The Sabha was consulted to resolve questions of Dharma and to decide the course of action in a given situation. We just saw that the king has been advised never to take a decision without consultation. This consultation could be a limited one with his ministers, or it could be an extensive consultation which is done in Dharma, which is done in a Sabha. We see many Sabhas in the Ramayana. After Dasharatha's death, it is the Sabha which decides to invite Bharata to be the king. Bharata rejects the offer, saying that it is against Dharma of Ikshvakus for a younger brother to be king when the elder brother is alive. Again, we see that when Vali does not return from his fight with the Rakshasa, it is the Sabha which decides that Sugriva should be crowned the king. Even Ravanasura convenes a Sabha to decide the course of action once Hanuman is captured. We have one more Sabha when the war council, when Rama and his army come to the gates of Lanka. So we see that the king holds consultations, and Sabha is extensively used to decide the question of Dharma. It's not that Sabha is always right, as some of these examples show, but Sabha played a very important part in deciding what Dharma is. So the interplay is like this. The king was supposed to uphold Dharma, and the king consulted the Sabha to both seek advice on what the appropriate course of action is and also to confirm his decisions. As I said, we see that Bharata did not accept the decision of the Rajakartaraha that he should accept the kingdom. Instead, he convinced the council that Rama should be approached and requested to come back and rule. In the war council that I just spoke about, Vibhishana advises Ravana to return Sita. In the Sabha, he speaks very openly. And then Ravana then asks the council to reconsider the question. And after much deliberation, they end up banishing Vibhishana. Similarly, before accepting Vibhishana in his camp, Rama seeks advice from his own counselors, who all give their opinion. And we see that as given in the training of a king, the king listens to all the opinions and then forms his decision, which was to accept Vibhishana. Similarly, Dasaratha's proposal to anoint Rama as a Yuvaraja was presented to the Sabha for their consent, and there's an overwhelming approval that we see there. Therefore, we see that the king's main duty was to uphold Dharma, and Sabha played a very important part in both deciding what Dharma is and in confirming that a decision is as per Dharma. Now, the big question is decided. We can look at the administrative structure of that we find in Ramayana. Ramayana describes Dasaratha and later Rama as having 8 amatyas or sachivas, including Sumantra. Please note that I am using only the words amatyas and sachivas, not mantris. Mantris are used in a slightly different sense in Ramayana. Sumantra was also the charioteer and a sort of personal secretary to Dasharatha. This gives us a sense of what these amatyas were doing. In addition to these amatyas, there were the ritviks. 2 main ritviks are mentioned, Vasishtha and Vamadeva. We cannot say there are only 2 ritviks, because ritviks are actually people who preside over a sacrifice, and different sacrifices require a different number of ritviks. We can say that Vasishtha and Vamadeva were the main ritviks. Though the primary duty of ritviks is in conducting yajnas, it is clear from Ramayana that they also gave advice in matters of state when asked for. Then we hear of 7 other hereditary mantris Suyajna, Jabali, Kasyapa, Gautama, Markandeya, Dirghayu and Katyayana. The Amatyas and Mantris together are referred to as the Rajakartaraha. Literally, it means those who make the king. It is this group of Rajakartaraha, Amatyas and Mantris, who request Vasishtha, who kind of delegate their power to Vasishtha and request him to invite a suitable prince. You know, once Rama and Lakshmana left, they were Bharata and Shatrughna, and there could be other contenders. So this council of kingmakers said, told Vasishtha, sir, please anoint, invite a suitable person. So these were the key administrative heads of the political setup in Ramayana that we see. If you look at the Sabha or Parishad is presided over by the king. Amatyas, Ritviks and Mantris are in attendance. The Sabha included the nobles of the Kshatriya Varna and the elite among Vaishyas, that is Naigamas and Sreshtins. They were also present. In the Sabha, which was conveyed before deciding Rama as a Yuvaraja, other kings in the empire were also invited, with the exceptions of the kings of Kekaya and Videha. That is, the father-in-law of Kaikeyi and the father-in-law of Sita were both not invited, but other kings in the empire were also invited. We should understand that different sabhas had a different composition. So one feature of the coronation sabha was that all other Samanta rajas were also invited. Otherwise, we see that leading citizens or representatives of Patanas, Nagaras, Ghoshas, Gramas, etc. These are normally called Mahattaras. They were also invited. And citizens of the capital called Pura and the countryside called Janapada or Rashtra also attend. We must emphasize that there was no fixed composition of Sabha. Different Sabhas that we come across in Ramayana seem to have different compositions. But to summarize, it would involve people of all the four Varnas, the nobles and the elite among Vaishyas, along with representatives of smaller administrative units and general people as well. This is an interesting question. Was there a representative assembly? Since we are studying Ramayana in depth to understand the political structure, this question comes up. Today, like we have the Lok Sabha, was there a representative assembly at the time of Ramayana? Many modern scholars opine that the term Paura Janapada refers to two houses with representatives of Pura and Janapada, with a further outer Bahya and an inner Abhyantara division. But if you look at traditional commentators on Ramayana, they interpret the term Paura Janapada to mean the citizens of Pura and Janapada. There need not be a contradiction here in my view. A leading citizen tends to be the official representative. Even today, if we go into the villages, we see that the leading citizen is also the official representative. The sense of Valmiki is that people's opinion is to be gauged. Valmiki does not say it is a representative assembly, but he is very clear that certain decisions need the adara of people. They should have acceptance among people. And gauging people's opinion could be through inviting citizens, leading citizens or official representatives. This opinion, we have strength from other texts like Mahabharata, Arthashastra, etc. also. But what can be said is that there is no clear proof that it was a representative assembly. But practically speaking, it could very well be representative given the rigid structure of the society. Next, we come across a very interesting aspect called Tirthas. Tirthani, Ramayana says, only the name Tirthani is mentioned. The number of Tirthas is not mentioned. The list that is given is from other texts such as Arthashastra and Mahabharata. These are the 18 administrative heads and these are well known. The mention on Ramayana gives us no doubt that 18 Tirthani were intended, because in the particular aspect, Rama teaching the science of government to Bharata says that amongst 18 Tirthas, you must spy 15 of your own Tirthas and 18 of your enemies. So we do know that Ramayana mentions 18 Tirthas. Those are the Mantri, Purohita, Yuvaraja, Senapati, Dauvarika, Antarvamsika, Karagaradhikrit, Arthasanchayakrit, Karya Niyojaka, Pradvivaka, Senanayaka, Nagaradhyaksha, Karmantika, Sabhya, Dharmadhyaksha, Dandapala, Durgapala, Rashtrantarapala. Some of these terms are very clear to us. Some of them are ambiguous. For example, what is a Senapati and who is a Senanayaka? We have given here the popular view among scholars that one is the commander, another is army paymaster. Similarly, Pradvivaka and Dharmadhyaksha, there is an overlap, and so on and so forth. We better stick to the Sanskrit names because these are given in the text. So this was the structure of the administration that we just saw. If you come to local administration, the 18 Tirthas were the departmental heads. There was an intelligence department which occupied a very important place, which spied upon the king's own Tirthas. So such was the polity at that time. Rama asks Bharata whether Bharata is spying on his own Tirthas. We see that in Ramayana, except the first three and those of the surrounding kings. Evidently, there was a very strong municipal administration which kept the city of Ayodhya clean, which provided street lighting in Ayodhya, and which controlled the crowds in Ayodhya. Ayodhya also had an irrigation system and did not depend on rains. It is very prominently mentioned, this aspect in Ramayana. There were roads across the kingdom on which chariots could travel. Different types of water bodies are mentioned. There must have been some local administration taking care of all this, though we don't get full details from Ramayana. Because being a Kavya, some of these mundane details are avoided there. But there is nothing in Ramayana to contradict the details found in other ancient texts. From that, we can figure out that there was a very well-defined local administration of the Ghoshas, which were pastoral villages, of the Gramas, which were agricultural villages, and Patanas and Nagaras, which are basically towns and cities. Now, let us look at the political organization of society. There are two aspects to it. One is the division along Varna. As you are aware, there are four Varnas. It is important to differentiate Varna from Jati. Varna comes from Rui to choose, profession chosen. It is a professional organization. Jati is what is there by birth, what we can call as caste. So Ramana talks about four Varnas of the Brahmanas, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. It also talks of the four ashramas, the Brahmacharya, Grihasthashrama, Vanaprasthashrama, and the fourth one, normally today we call it sannyasa, but in Ramayana we find the terms Yati and Parivrajaka to denote a sannyasin. And then the king's duty was to maintain Varna Ashrama Dharma. That means each of the professions had to do their own professional duty, the Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudras. And each of the persons in the respective ashramas were supposed to follow duties of that ashrama. This we side on one aspect of the political or social organization is this. The other one was that there was an empire, there were states within that, and within the state there were local administrative units like Grama, Ghosha, Nagara and Patana. There were also trade guilds called Shrenis in cities. We look at the political organization more. Dasaratha specifically states to Kaikeyi that he has control over Sindhu, Sauvira, Saurashtra, Dravida, Dakshinapatha, Vanga, Anga, Kosala, Magatha and Matsya states. Rama declares that he is acting as a representative of Bharata in killing Rakshasas in the unsettled areas of Dandakaranya. Rama is recorded in Ramayana as having installed his own children and those of his brothers as kings of various kingdoms. Tribute from Samanta kings is recognized as a source of revenue. So these are all textual evidences for existence of an empire. But modern scholars opine that there was no Ikshvaku empire because imperialism of the later years, such as the Mauryan Empire, is not seen. We can conclude that the empire was markedly different from later versions, but we cannot wish away that Ramayana attests to the existence of an empire. If you look at the division of state, the kingdom was divided into capital and countryside called Pura and or Rajadhani, or the countryside was called Janapada, Rashtra, Vishaya, etc. The Janapada had villages and towns. The villages were mainly Grama, agricultural villages, or Ghosha, pastoral villages. The towns were Nagaras or Patanas. Some people believe Patanas were port towns, but we cannot say that conclusively. Representatives of both territories, called Mahattaras and various guilds, are mentioned prominently. In the towns, the trading folks had their own trade guilds, and the representatives of these were called Naigamas. These find prominent mention. Every sabha has a few Naigamas. Now, if you look at the interstate relationships, the mandala theory was what was clearly followed in Ramayana. We have three aspects called evaluation of textual evidence, the mandala theory, and responsibility of conquering state. We'll examine each in turn. If you look at the textual evidence, we see that there were wars between states under different pretexts. Sometimes the relative of the vanquished king was installed. Often relatives of the conqueror were established as the king. In the Kachit Sarga, number 100 of Ayodhya Kanda, Rama touches upon many aspects of Dandaniti, about gathering intelligence, about the prakritis of a kingdom, and he refers to the mandala theory and the six strategies of interstate relationships, together known as Shatgunya. These are all clearly mentioned. There are all the elements of Shatgunya are individually mentioned in the text at different places. So this is the evidence that we have. From this evidence, we can conclude that the mandala theory or the mandala framework was what? The framework of interstate relationships. What does the mandala theory say? We have expanded this in paper on Arthashastra, but very briefly, it classifies neighboring kings into 12 types and recommends an evaluation of six prakritis, that is king, minister, countryside, fort, treasury, and army, of each of these 12. Based on the analysis of these 72 elements, that is the six prakritis of the 12 kinds of kings, six types of actions are recommended. This is what I refer to as Shatgunya. First action is sandhi, that is peace, or there could be war, vigraha. Sometimes neutrality is the best course. It's called asana, sitting on one's own seat, or yana. This is short of war, but marching towards war. Often we see in modern times that two countries don't actually fight, but they mobilize their armies. That is, they make as if they're about to start a war. This is one of the strategies. Then we have samshraya, or surrender to a more powerful king. In today's world, we call it alignment. Then there is dvaidi bhava, that is, on one friend there is war, another friend there is peace, depending on the relative assessment of the strengths and weaknesses. Now, as the Arthashastra shows, the analysis can be very fine. It is not this simplistic. Though Ramayana does not get into such detail, it is unmistakable that the decision making with reference to interstate relations was made within the framework of this mandala theory. Also mentioned are the four devices, upayas called Samadana Bheda Dandopayas. These are very well known. Then the calamities to the various prakritis are also mentioned in the Ramayana. From all this, it is very safe to say that there is a broad agreement between Ramayana and Arthashastra with respect to interstate relationships. Now, one key feature we just examine next is that the conqueror has a responsibility. Today we live in a world where superpowers conquer small states and then anarchy is resulting. They don't take the responsibility of governance. Such was not the case earlier. The conqueror had a duty to provide stability in the conquered kingdom. Thus, we see that every war is followed by a stable solution. This is one effect of the supremacy of dharma, rather than self-interest of the conqueror. A conqueror could not merely plunder a kingdom and shun the responsibility of governance. This also confirms agreement between Ramayana and Arthashastra, because a similar kind of responsibility is laid down in the Arthashastra. Having considered the polity in Ramayana, just let's take a step back and consider the continuity of polity in India. We see that there are similarities with descriptions in Vedas where sabhas and samitis are mentioned. With later works such as Mahabharata and Arthashastra, we've just looked at complete agreement between Arthashastra and Ramayana, and also various works on Dharma Shastra. In fact, this commonality is not merely in literature. The Ashtapradhan of Shivaji were not very different from the eight Amatyas of Dasharatha or Rama. The idea of maintaining Varnashrama Dharma as the duty of kings is seen across Indian literature spanning two millennia. The king as the upholder of Dharma and as beholden to Dharma is the model which obtains throughout the historical period. Thus, we can say that there has been a remarkable continuity in the polity of India. In fact, including the tax rate of Shadbhaga or 1/6, the old Indian tax rate was always 16%. In conclusion, we can summarize like this. The Ramayana is an important integral part of the group of texts which portray ancient Indian polity. There is a remarkable continuity in the general features of Indian polity. While other forms of governance were known, the primary one is that of dharmic kingship. Here the kingdom is seen as a trust, that the king is holding the kingdom in trust, We see this very clearly in the interplay between Bharata and Rama, where they treat kingdom as a duty and not as something as a right. And Arajakatva was a much feared state. Throughout, we see that in literature, especially in Ramayana also. As Ramayana so gloriously portrays, kingship is a trust, and the king earns his wages by serving the people. It is not a surprise then that in the 20th century, Mahatma Gandhi conveyed his vision of independent India to the public using one word. He said, "Let us establish Ramarajya." Thank you.